The following is a non-verdict based research versus show. The stats of the individual characters are not taken into consideration when determining aspects of the fight. However, the characters themselves are going to be represented in their fullest capacity outside of stats.
This is versus universe.
A samurai. A devoted warrior with a singular mission in his mind. To save the world he inhabits. But what if that world didn't want saving? What if he was too young to realize his ambitions? Well, he could always leave it to the next generation, and only use one arm in the process. Dunban, the hero of the Homs from Xenoblade Chronicles, and Auron, the legendary guardian from Final Fantasy. Let's begin! Long ago, the world was nothing but an endless sea, cloaked in a boundless sky. Then, two great titans came into existence, the Bionis and the Mechanis. On one side, there's the biological life of the Bionis, home to the Homs. And on the other, there is mechanical life on Mechanis, quite creatively named Mechon. The Homs and Mechon are locked in an endless war with each other, with the Mechon using Homs as their sustenance and the Homs not liking that very much. Only one thing could ever cut through the metal of a Mechon. The legendary sword that was supposedly once wielded by the Bionis itself, the Monado. This weapon may appear like a cheap piece of plastic at first, but it is essentially a sheath for the blue saber it houses underneath its red casing. With the sword of the Bionis itself, none on Mechanis stand a chance against the might of the wielder. Only a god themselves may stand in their way. But not just anybody can wield the Monado. It takes a certain chosen criteria that most on both Bionis and Mechanis fail to meet. But in spite of that, it doesn't stop people from trying. Anyone can activate it, but only few can tame it. This is the story of the first ever Homs to use the Monado. He was not chosen, but in spite of that, his will carries him through the hardships. This is the story of Dunban. He fought alongside his brethren, including his two mates Dixon, the Hulk Hogan-looking motherfucker, and Mumkar, the other one, on the Mechanis' sword itself in one of the many battles waged in this endless war. However, Dunban soon found himself succumbing to the Monado's will. He's strong, but even he has limits. Mumkar did a gay little runaway from Dunban and Dixon, deserting them in favor of saving his own skin, but he soon found out that war isn't really that great. The battle was a stalemate, with many Homs giving their lives in pursuit of true freedom from the vile Mechon, as Dunban puts it. 1 year later, and he is still treating his wound from handling the Monado, the sword basically rendering his right arm useless. Settled in his home in Call 89 with his sister Fiora, everything was looking alright for the time being. The world was at an unprecedented period of peace, but that peace rarely lasts. One fateful night, the Mechon attacked Colony 9, which is really weird since the settlement is located on the Bionis' ankle. But eventually, it came time for Dunban to take the Monado one more time. But his body could barely handle a spoon, let alone the sword that put him into this paralytic state in the first place. He quickly succumbed again, and then something incredible happened. A researcher named Shulk, whom Dunban was acquainted thanks to his sister giving him the fuck me eyes every time they speak, took the blade of the Bionis into his hands and wielded it with a finesse that even Dunban was amazed at. Moving onward so that they could clean house with any Mechon they saw, they eventually got roadblocked by a Mechon with a face, something they've never seen before. Nothing, not even the Monado, worked on this Mechon, and in a desperate bid to save Dunban, Shulk and this other guy's life, Fiora rammed into it. But it didn't end well for her. Not at all. After the Mechon retreated, Shulk and that other guy went out on a quest to get revenge on that faced fucker for killing his girlfriend. But Dunban stayed behind, looking to treat his wounds further before he could fight alongside the two. And he did just that. He took his time, and after Shulk, that guy, a girl, and Juju were on their way out of the Bionis' leg, who should appear before them, sword in hand, but the hero of the Homs, Dunban. So, Dunban fights a little differently without the Monado, meaning he only uses one arm, presumably his non-dominant one. Still, it takes more than the loss of a measly limb to keep this man down. Dunban is a heavy hitter, but not without caveats. He's something called a dodge tank, which is basically exactly what it says, an attacker that relies on dealing heavy blows, but all the while making sure that an enemy cannot hit them themselves.
But he is still just a Homs. It takes more than brute tenacity to take down a Mechon or 100. So he utilizes something called the Aether. Think of it like a magical forest that surrounds Bionis and Mechonis that certain people can draw from to gain power. Though notably, it takes a very high-skilled individual to become a full-blown mage. But that hasn't stopped Dunban from adding abilities called Arts that use the Aether to his advantage. Like Gale Slash, which can inflict bleeding, and Soaring Tempest, which he like does a little twirl into the air and like goes this and like comes back down. It's really cool, you just kind of gotta see it. That one does not have the best accuracy though, I have to be honest. But speaking of, he can actually boost his accuracy using things called Auras, which are when he uses an art to use Aether to boost his stats rather than just using it offensively. Two of his best Auras are Jaws of Death and Heat Haze. The former can heal wounds and remove statuses, while the latter can remove aggro and increase his crit chances. He can also perform the three-stage combo, Break, Topple, and Daze, though not in the order you'd normally find. He can do Break into Topple just fine, but to use his Daze art, Thunder, he needs to have an aura active for it to actually work. However, all of this is overshadowed when Dunban realizes that it's time to break out his talent art. I'll let it speak for itself.
Born in a world of strife, against the odds, we choose to fight! Blossom Dance!
While not holding a candle to the Monado and raw power, these abilities served Dunban well when he came to actively join Shulk and that guy and girl's party. Their journey took them all the way to the top of the Bionis, where a couple crazy things Ryan and Charla. I just remember their names. Thank God, that clone that shoots other clones is getting trigger happy. He was aiming for me if I didn't remember next. Fighting with a bird lady and Ricky they found along the way, the party soon found themselves at the top of the Bionis at Prison Island. It was there that the bird lady's dad died, Shulk got Monado Mark II, and, Fiora was revealed to be alive. But she didn't remember anything. Her and that faced Mechon from Colony 9 retreated, but Metalface showed up soon after to confirm Dunman's suspicions. He is, in fact, Mumkar. You know, the gay run guy. Instead of being relieved at an old war buddy being alive, Dunban was instead rightly pissed off and dueled with him after an introspective conversation. Why would you do this?
IDK, bro, I just like having metal skin.
Die.
Fuck.
How could you kill innocent people?
I want the Monando V movies.
Hey guys, how's it going? It's me, Aegon, leader of Mechonis, and Mumkar's not there right now, young man.
Don't tell me what to do, Dad.
I love you, son.
What on Bionis is going on?
Holy shit, it's Fiora. Surely she must remember the meme.
The Sunmellows over there!
It didn't work. So they all went to Mechonis and fell to their deaths. If it wasn't for a conveniently placed beach that happened to save them all. Here, the party came to a new purpose, to defeat Aegil atop Mechonis. And so they trekked back there, but not before meeting Mumkar one last time. Attempting to kill the traitor, Dunban's blade was actually stopped by Shulk, who before this seemed to have the most bloodlust of anyone in the party. Shulk's words to Dunban moved him in a way he hadn't before, as the student officially became the teacher. Mumkar still fell to his death like a fucking idiot, but it's important to know that it wasn't Dunban or Shulk's fault. And so, everyone continued onward. Also, Fiora got better and she and Dunban hugged. It was wholesome 100. Dunban and the others made their way to the top of the Mechonis. With the Monado suddenly not working for Shulk, the blade starting to paralyze the boy just like it had done for Dunban before. Also, they killed Charla's boyfriend? It was epic. For now, Shulk managed to control the blade, and they started their fight against Aegil. It wasn't easy, and he very nearly destroyed the entire Bionis, but Dunban and the party had persevered in the end. Then, something happened. Dixon shot Shulk after he refused to kill Aegil. So, the entire game, Shulk was the incubator for the god of Bionis, Sansa, to reform himself. Maneth, the god of Mechonis, was doing the same in Fiora. Dixon shot Shulk to get Sansa out of him, and in turn made Shulk re-die. Oh yeah, he was dead the whole time. Sansa just, like, possessed him for most of the game. After Maneth attempted and failed to defeat Sansa, it was up to the party. Then, Shulk came back. That didn't take long. With their blonde baby boy back, the gang went to Prison Island once again to face off against Dixon in their final bout. And although they beat him with ease, no one was happy with his outcome. Dixon doesn't really like dying, Fiora and Ryan lost an adult figure they'd known all their lives, and Shulk lost his mentor, but Dunban lost his last friend. And although he had certainly made bonds with everyone in the party at this point, he couldn't even look at his old friend's face as he turned away to move forward and face Sansa. That is Dunban's most admirable quality. The resolve to acknowledge the past, and instead of looking back on the pain and sorrow, he can look forward and see the untapped potential of the future. The ability to shape the future into what you see in spite of the blood and turmoil that came before. It's only then that a man can truly blossom into a hero. Anyway, they killed God, lol.
Munka!
You went too far, you fool.
Within the world, therein exists two possible realities. The one of the real, and the one of dreams. To go freely between the two is no small feat, but to do that, one would have to be a legend. In the city of Xanarkand, there was a boy, Titus. And yes, that's how I pronounce his name. I don't need a whole hydrosity situation on my hands. Yeah, great. Now all the comments on this video are going to be from people complaining about my pronunciation of hydrosity. Well, I mean, speaking of water, a perfect segue, me. The people of Xanarkand really only love one thing. Blitzball. Which is something I completely understand and I'm just choosing to not go over because it is totally not confusing. Titus is one of the premier stars of Blitzball, or rather, he was. That is, until a water monster ravaged the city and left it all torn asunder. Okay, are we sure this isn't Sonic? While this creature was attacking the city, Titus sought his only true compatriot at the time, the legendary guardian, Sir Auron. See, Auron was a close friend of Titus's father, Jekt. But one day, Jekt did the whole I'm going to the store to buy milk bit, but for real, and left Titus and his mother alone. Since Auron was close with Jekt, he thought it would be best if he were to watch over the boy. But now, there was actual danger for the first time in this dreamlike city, and it kinda absolutely fucked everything up. So much so that when Titus finally wakes up from the attack, he ends up in some kind of ruins that looks completely alien to him. That's because, as he soon learns, he was not in Xanarkand anymore. He was transported to the land of Spira. And what's weirder is that people here say that Xanarkand exists, but it's been destroyed for a very long time. And on top of that, people here live in constant fear of getting fucking annihilated by the fucker that attacks Xanarkand, the monster known as Sin. While it's possible to defeat this huge monster, no solution has been permanent. The land of Spira is in a state of constant suffering, only being quelled by people known as High Summoners. And these people actively dedicate their entire lives to taking the Whale Man down. And people who accompany High Summoners on their journeys as they gain power to defeat Sin are called Guardians. Pretty much as soon as he got there, Titus was roped into becoming the guardian of Lady Yuna, who, it has been said, is possibly the next in line to defeat Sin. Some stuff happens and then Auron shows back up, and Titus was not pleased. Titus is kinda a whiny bitch, but like the fun kind. It was here the boy learned that Auron is a legendary guardian in this world, having aided Braska, who's both Yuna's dad and the last guy to defeat Sin. So, Auron accompanied Yuna's party on their long trek through the land of Spira, and he brought his own, quite potent, battlefield skills to the table. So, Auron is a really powerful character, not only in the lore of the game, but also the gameplay. This man does a lot of damage, but doesn't have the best chances to hit enemies. He also has no trouble clashing against armored enemies, as all of his weapons have a piercing skill that allows him to cut through any shell. This studiousness to the art of battle was brought about by Auron once being a devout warrior monk of Yu Yevon. Just think of Yu Yevon like Spear in Jesus Christ. Like this Xemnas right here. Except really old. Really old. This is why Auron only uses one arm. He will only go all out when he absolutely has to. And spoiler alert, but he's pretty much always on top of the game.
Also, he needs a free hand to drink, so, like, he needs two hands to do two different things. Well, I feel you. Well, he normally just has, like, a normal sword. The most powerful version of that sword, the Masamune. Not that one. Has a special trait to it. That being, the lower Auron's health is, the more damage it deals. Auron can also employ special abilities both to aid his allies and also to fuck with whoever he's fighting. For instance, he can take a hit for an ally, or he can transfer his energy to somebody else, or he could lower his enemy's magical or physical defense, or just threaten them, and not with a good time. Really, the only unique ability Auron has access to is something called the zombie attack, which will inflict the zombie status on any enemy it touches. Bro's gonna make you do the thriller dance. But Auron's most powerful techniques are his overdrives. When he dishes out enough damage, a special gauge will get built up that when it's full, he can unleash a devastatingly powerful attack that deals massive damage. You know, I'll let it speak for itself. Badass. But you know what's not badass? Organized religion. See, basically everyone on Spira, except for these guys called the Albed, believe in Yu Yevon. They believe that the world cannot be free of the cycle of sin, and so they live in complacency until they inevitably die. Idiots. Well, I mean, it's not like they're wrong, but still, there's still a lot of prejudice going around in these Yevonites. Especially Wonka. That man would rather eat his own arm whole than talk to an Albed. This whole High Summoner business is a product of Yevon's teachings, and really those are more like his daughter's, Lady Unaleska. See, every summoner's journey ends in the Xanarkan Dome, where they learn the truth of their final summoning. That, in order to complete the ritual, the guardian with the closest bond to them must sacrifice themselves. 10 years prior to Titus landing in Spira, Braska, Jekt, and Auron arrived at this temple. When they learned the truth, it wasn't pretty. Despite Jekt sacrificing himself for Braska, and Braska also dying during the ceremony, Auron was left alone. And keep in mind, he was a devout Yevonite, but this casual disregard for the bonds he had formed with these two men, it toiled on him. And it made him do something that he would immediately regret. He attacked the person who had told him how to perform the final summoning, Lady Unaleska herself. In their fight, Auron stood no chance. After getting his right eye scarred, he fled the fight to make sure Braska's daughter would be safe. And finally succumbing to his wounds, he was no longer a member of the living. That's right. Auron has been dead this whole time. But in his death, he became something called an Unsent. Basically somebody that refuses to go to Final Fantasy X's afterlife, called the Far Plane, when their bonds and promises run too deep. Quickly after becoming an Unsent, Auron went to a place where he knew Jack's son, Titus, would be, the dream of the long-lost Xanarkand. And when that ship sailed, he joined Yuna and Titus on their journey against Sin. But that's not all. See, Sin isn't just some random monster. The reason why a guardian must be sacrificed in the final summoning is because they will turn into Sin. That's right, Jekt is Sin. And upon reaching the Xanarkand Dome with Titus and Yuna, he revealed his Unsent status to the boy. He also got some much-needed revenge against Unaleska, so good for him. And soon after, the party came up with a plan to get rid of Sin for good. The spirit of Yu Yevon was inside Sin, and through defeating that, they could then stop the endless cycle of death and destruction. And nobody would have to die! Except for the Seymour fucker. Fuck him. And when all was said and done, and Jekt was finally laid to rest, it was time for Auron to go. All of his promises to Jekt and Braska had been fulfilled, and it was time for him to move on. Upon finally entering the Far Plane, he had but one thing to say to everyone who had embraced this new world without the need for Yevon. This is your world now. And so, the legendary guardian entered the Far Plane, never to be seen on Spira again. Finally in the company of Jekt and Braska, and soon followed by Titus, as he was a byproduct of the dreams of Sin, why Auron was free from his pain and sorrow. And then he met a homophobic Hades and got adopted by Duck and Dog stepdads.
But even then, that's his story. And it'll be his until the end of time.
Now! This is it! Now is the time to choose! Die and be free of pain! Or live and fight your sorrow! Now is the time to shape your stories! Your fate is in your hands!
We open to a shot of Dunban arriving in a large field known to some as the Far Plain, having been just transported there by the Nopon Archsage. Before he left, the Nopon mentioned something about a guardian that excited him to an alarming degree, but Dunban was never one to turn down a request. So he agreed to this duel, but was hesitant that he was not allowed his allies. So he waits in this dreamscape for his opponent. Suddenly, a man garbed in red with sunglasses covering his eyes appears before the hero of the Homs. Noticing his sword, Dunban begins to perk up, standing upright as he draws his blade.
Guardian, I presume.
Auron simply stands still whilst replying.
To some.
Well, you don't seem too bad. Fancy a spa?
Auron notices Dunban's injured arm and exercises caution.
Are you sure? Your right arm is almost certainly unusable.
Oh, that. I suppose when you enter the unknown, you're bound to forget that people don't know you or your struggles. I'm Dunban.
Auron.
Well, Auron, like I said, fancy a duel.
Auron then finally takes a stance against Dunban.
I see no reason why not to.
May the best man win.
Auron rushes Dunban, their blades clashing with the might of Dunban's left arm meeting Auron's right. The sickly tang of metal screeching against itself permeates the far plane, souls crying out in agony over the sound. Auron notices this, and takes his sword and begins swinging at Dunban. The blades clash many a time, horizontal slash meaning vertical and vice versa, before Dunban begins evading Auron's attacks without using his sword. Pushing Auron's sword aside with a backhand, Dunban creates an opening and uses an art on the legendary guardian.
Gale Slash!
Dunban's sword pierces Auron's body, but nothing happens to the guardian.
So much for a friendly duel.
That's peculiar. Why aren't you bleeding?
You mean to tell me that you aren't of the Far Plain? Are you even from Spira?
Ah, so that's the name of this place. No, I'm afraid not. My world is that of the Bionis, though I doubt you've heard of it.
Can't say I have. I've been all over my world. I assume the same of you.
Oh yes. We met many people. Napan, Hyensia, Machna.
Machina? I thought they were extinct.
We did too, until we... Oh, you probably mean a different kind of Machina. Perhaps our worlds aren't so different, Auron. But more importantly, why didn't you bleed?
This is the Far Plain. It's where the souls of those willing go to spend eternity in my world. I am among these souls.
Sounds nice, knowing what happens at death. For how much I brush with it, I never thought much about what lies on the other side.
So that confirms it. You aren't dead.
Auron then attacks Dunban while he is contemplating their conversation, inflicting the hero of the Homs with a zombie status.
Did you forget this was a fight? I thought you were a warrior.
Dunban then rises and uses his Jaws of Death art to cure himself of the status Auron put him under.
I'm no warrior! I'm a hero! Soaring Tempest!
Circling around in midair, Dunban slashes around Auron's general area, but finds himself missing most of the attacks. Some land on the Guardian, but not all. This causes him to cast Serene Heart on himself, buffing his accuracy.
Your pain shall be twofold!
Auron then uses his Power Break skill on Dunban, lowering his strength and greatly injuring the Homs, and Auron also begins to ready his Overdrive.
Show me your resolve!
Auron then plummets his sword into the ground, and while nothing happens immediately, the ground beneath Dunban suddenly erupts as he is blown back into the air. He uses the opportunity to regroup his form and flips midair into a back roll, mitigating damages done to his body. Thunder then rolls around Auron, as Dunban has dazed him before walking up to the Guardian.
You asked for my resolve! I shall demonstrate!
Dunban then activates Heat Haze, but before he can get out his next attack, Auron begins drinking from his jug.
Are you drinking? During a fight?
Not much it can do for the dead. It just reminds me of a time long gone. People that are no longer around.
Fate's worse than death, eh? I've definitely seen my fair share of those.
Dunban then takes the opportunity while Auron is distracted thinking of his fallen comrades to backhand him in the face.
Consider that payback for earlier. Now to—
Enough!
Auron, clearly more serious in his tone now, begins to charge up a massive attack. This is his final gambit. His final attack. He creates a gigantic tornado to envelop Dunban, and while the hero of the Homs is stuck midair, Auron begins to taunt him.
This ends now!
Auron then chucks his jug of alcohol at the tornado, causing it to explode in uproarious flames, scorching the Farplane's delicate flowers, perhaps forever. Dunban, however, remains in the air as he begins his own chant.
Born in a world of strife!
Riding the flames of the tornado, Dunban falls while slashing at Auron diagonally, much to the surprise of the legendary Guardian.
Against the odds!
Another slash befits Auron's chest, this time horizontally striking his abdomen.
We choose to fight!
Dunban swings his sword against Auron, this time while twirling around and launching himself into the air. He has but one last thing to say.
Blossom, dance!
Once again, Dunban comes crashing downwards on Auron, slicing through the foregone body of a life long gone. Auron then gets up and walks past Dunban, contemplatively.
You remind me of myself. When I was younger, I thought I could save the world. I was wrong. I was stupid. I thought, maybe—
That everything was up to you.
Auron is taken aback by Dunban's wisdom.
Yes. I had to learn the hard way that the next generation would be the one to do what I could not. And so I helped them, however I could.
I did the exact same. I'm starting to see now why that Nopon wanted us to meet.
So when this fight ends, you'll go back to your home?
If this is anything like those other battles, then yes.
Auron smirks a little, showing a pure emotion for the first time in the fight other than rage.
Then what say we finish this? No magic, no powers, just metal facing metal.
Could do without the words metal and face next to each other, but that sounds wonderful.
They both pace back from each other, getting equal footing before rushing in for the final blow. Only one hero will stand after their swords clash. As they both rush in at each other, Auron swings wildly, putting all of his might behind this mighty blow. However, Dunban quickly, but not without effort, evades the blow mid-run and slashes at Auron's chest, making the Guardian keel over in defeat.
Ah, you won.
No hot feelings, I hope.
Dunban reaches out a hand for Auron to get up, and Auron gladly accepts. They keep their hands held against one another as Dunban begins to dissipate back to the Bionis.
I'm afraid our time is cut short.
I hope to see you again, Dunban. Perhaps when your skills are even sharper.
Let's not forget who won our little duel here.
Dunban nods solemnly while looking Auron dead in his eyes.
Well, take care.
With pleasure, friend.
Dunban then gets carried into the ether, away from Auron and Spira. The Guardian waves goodbye to his new comrade, as back on the Bionis, both Ryan and Shulk were awaiting Dunban's emergence.
Well, that little scuffle is over.
Shulk looks onward to his mentor as Dunban hides his face from the boy.
You won, right?
I did, but not without effort. My opponent, let's continue on our journey.
As Ryan walks away from the two, towards the rest of the party, Dunban takes Shulk aside for a moment.
Shulk, I was transported to a world. The man I fought, he was a dead soldier. He made me realize something, that I needed to live more in the moment. So from here on out, you can count on me.
Shulk simply smiles while reassuring Dunban.
Dunban, you don't get it. We already look up to you. Not because you're a war hero, but because you're the best of us. No matter what, we'll have your back, just like you've got ours.
Dunban is taken aback by Shulk's wisdom, much like how Auron was taken aback by his.
Shulk, I thank you.
No problem. Now come on, we have work to do.
Yes.
Dunban looks on at the endless sea from the top of the Bionis, seeing the sun graze the ocean just right as his eyes fill with tears. Dunban looks on at the endless sea from the top of the Bionis, seeing the sun graze the ocean just right as his eyes fill with tears. A single one escaping his ducts and crawling down his cheek, he makes a declaration.
Auron, yours is not a name I shall forget. I will see you again, friend. I promise.
Dunban then walks away from the sunset towards his group, with a new resolve in his heart. Perhaps nobody will truly know the change that went through the hero of the Homs. But as long as he's alive, he will keep the wisdom of the legendary guardian in his heart. As they both rush in at each other, Auron swings wildly, putting all of his might behind this mighty blow. However, Dunban quickly, but not without effort, evades the blow mid-run, but Auron predicted this and countered his evasion with a gut check with his other hand, and slices Dunban's chest, cleaving through the arms. While the sword does not graze Dunban's vital organs, it's enough to leave him unconscious.
I'm sorry, but I know you didn't come here to die. To live and fight your sorrow, that is a precious gift. Do not waste it as I have, Dunban.
Duly noted, a friend. I shall return stronger. I hope to see you then.
Auron smirks again while kneeling over Dunban's beaten body.
I look forward to that.
Dunban's body is sent through the ether back to the Bionis, and Auron simply strides towards the nearest undamaged field of flowers and sits down. He takes a swig of his jug of alcohol and begins his long wait. Suddenly, the spirit of Braska comes to Auron's side, making conversation with him.
He certainly reminds me of when you were younger.
You think I didn't notice the similarities? You'd have to be blind not to see.
Well, you're halfway there anyway.
I just hope he doesn't make our mistakes.
Braska looks onward, sighing as he replies.
I sincerely doubt he didn't listen to you. You've already helped Jack's son in a similar way, and he seemed more careful and responsive than that boy.
You could say that again.
Braska then sits down next to Auron.
Are you fit to spend the time until he shows up next sitting here with me, Auron?
Auron smiles as he too looks on at the far plain.
I see no reason why not.
After many months on the Bionis, Dunban re-emerged on the far plain after his defeat at Auron the first time around.
Sorry to keep you waiting.
Very well. Show me your strength!
As blades clash once again, the two one-armed warriors once again lock in combat. Who will win this bout? No one knows. But this time, there will be no animosity. These two men, born in worlds of strife and sorrow, now live their lives free of pain. And only when a guardian is free of pain is when he can truly rest.
I did it. I made an episode that wasn't longer than my fucking dick. Finally, we can rest now. Right? I mean, what else is there to say about this? It's not like I've chosen to fight God with how I wrote this fight. Like, I really have nothing else to say. Why have the fight set in the far plane? Because that's where Auron is at the end of his story in FF10. And it's not like living people can't come and go, especially whatever fucking weird magic the Nopon Archer has under his slimy, grubby little sleeves. Like, I really don't have anything to say that the fight or the analyses don't cover. Maybe I'm just too good. Or maybe this is just a straightforward episode. Either way, I'd appreciate seeing what you thought about the episode down below in the comments. Leave a like or a dislike. Ring that bell! And I'll see you next time on Versus Universe, the name of the show. Bye!